Essentially, this is digital data transmission over, it could be any media, lot of media affect the data in general, in a general way that is similar to what we will discuss. But here we will talk about the specific case of a wire. Now, a wire can be modeled to various levels. At the beginning, we will take a very simple model, that is that the wire can be represented by a single resistor and a capacitor. So, for first order systems, we can come up with analytical formulas. So, we can see what the effect of having the having non-zero resistance and capacitance is. This is the ideal system. You have data on this side and that appears on this side because this and this are perfect conductors. Now, I'll assume the same source. I'll say that the wire has some resistance and it has some capacitance, and I choose to model the capacitance by putting it on the right side. Okay. And I want to see what comes out. And my digital data, I'll assume that it is binary and consists of symbols which are either minus 1 volt or plus 1 volt. One of them stands for 0, one of the one stands for 1. And I will also assume that the data rate is FS. Okay. So the x-axis here is T over TS normalized to the sampling rate, sampling period TS. TS is nothing but the reciprocal of FS. The data could look something like this and so on. Right? This is minus 1, this is plus 1. And these are successive integer multiples of the sampling period TS. What do you expect to see at the output? Let's say initially the capacitor is charged to 0 volts. What do you expect to see at the output? What is the response of a first order RC system to this? Ramp. It's an exponential, right? The response of a first order system. So, and how the exponential looks like, the exact shape of the waveform you see depends on the value of RC, that is the RC product, nothing else. Okay. So let's say the value of RC is very small compared to TS. What do you expect to see in this case? There will be some rounding of the edges, but largely the data will look like what we sent. Okay. Now what do we do to receive the data? How do we receive the data? So let's say I was transmitting this digital data. What is, in your idea, a receiver? So we are not interested in the exact waveform. This is digital data. So we sample it at every TS because we know that the rate of changes, the data changes every TS, so we sample it. Now, for this data, it doesn't matter where in the duration of the bit you sample it. Okay. So I'll just say arbitrarily that we sample it at the end of the bit, and the next one is here, and the next one is here, and so on. And what are the sample values that I obtain? What are the sample values I get? 1 minus 1, the ideal values that represent the logic, the binary data. Okay. What about in this case? In this case also, I will say that I sample here. So, until we discuss clock recovery circuits, the time at which we sample will be something that we arbitrarily pick, somewhat based on intuition and where we seem to get the maximum signal to noise ratio. Okay. So, I sample it at these points. What do I get? Largely the same. In fact, we know that it will not be exactly 1 and minus 1, right? Because the exponential never truly decays. But it is close enough that we can say we have received the data ideally. Okay. Now, what happens if RC becomes comparable or larger than TS? It won't reach plus or minus 1. It won't reach the peaks. So, maybe let's say it will do something like this. So, if this had been a constant at plus 1 throughout, it would have reached it after a long time, but now it won't reach it. Now maybe after, because you have two consecutive minus 1s, it will reach the minus 1 value, but after that you have a single 1, so it won't reach the plus 1 value. Then again here you have a single minus 1, so it won't reach minus 1, but then you have a string of plus 1s, so it will reach plus 1 value slowly. Okay. So again I look at the samples of the receive data at integer multiples of TS. So, what is the observation here? What are the received values? It is different from the ideal value, and in this case they are in fact all less than the ideal value. Not only that, it's not the same for every minus 1 symbol, because this also represents a minus, this represents a minus 1, the next one is also a minus 1, but we get two different voltages for it. Okay, for the same symbol we get different voltages. Why is this? Why do we get a different value for this minus 1 and this minus 1? Initial condition is different, and why is the initial condition different? Start from, so it depends also on the previous bit. Okay, whereas ideally it didn't matter where you it didn't matter what the previous bit was, regardless of whether it was a 1 or a 0, 1 or a minus 1. If the data was minus 1, you would get minus 1 volt. Whereas in this case, if the previous data was plus 1, then you get somewhat smaller negative value. Previous data is minus 1, you get a larger negative value, which is perhaps closer to minus 1 volt. So the value that you receive for each symbol depends on the previous symbol and in general many previous symbols. Okay, so in theory it depends on every previous symbol, every symbol that was transmitted before the current symbol. Values depend on previous symbols, and this is known as inter-symbol interference, right? Each symbol affects the analog value that is received, not only for that symbol but for all following symbols, and perhaps also for all preceding symbols in theory. So this is usually called ISI, okay, inter-symbol interference. What is the consequence of this? Is there any significance to inter-symbol interference? Why is it important? What's that? Okay, can you elaborate more? What is SNR? Why? Yeah. What is that? So effectively all are different ways of saying the same thing. Either the signal to noise ratio is high or sensitivity is high. So what happens is there is always some noise added, which we model by a noise that is added after this channel. Okay, and after that you look at whether the input is, whether the data is positive or negative, to decide whether it is plus 1 or minus 1. You know that you are not going to get plus 1 volt and minus 1 volt. So the way you decide whether it's plus 1 or minus 1 is simply by looking at whether it's above 0 or below 0. But you have added noise. So the noise added can be, let's say it is random noise, it can be positive or negative of and you specify it by its variance. Okay, and depending on the variance of this noise n and the strength of the symbol that is transmitted, you can have a certain probability of error. Now the signal strength is reduced in some cases quite drastically, right? If it's a 1 followed by a minus 1, the amplitude for minus 1 is quite small. Similarly, if it is a minus 1, 1 and minus 1, the amplitude for the middle plus 1 is small. So if you have the same noise that is added to all of these symbols, the probability of error is high for this symbol and for this one. It is not, it is the same as in the ideal case for this. It is not as high as this one, but higher than this symbol for the middle one. Okay, so it depends on the signal to noise. Okay, you are familiar with the Q function. Okay, now how do you decide how much, if you add a certain amount of noise with a certain variance, how do you decide the bit error rate? How do you decide the bit error ratio given the noise variance? So the bit error ratio is, you transmit something, let's say a positive value, and what you receive is V plus N. Okay, and let's say if V is positive, the received quantity has to be positive. If V is positive and the received quantity V plus N is negative, then you have an error in the received bit. Okay, so the probability of V plus N being less than 0, given that V is greater than 0, this is the bit error rate. And it depends on both V and the size of the noise, and noise is measured by its root mean square value or the standard deviation. Okay, and let's assume, as we do quite commonly, that the noise is Gaussian and uncorrelated from one time instant to another, and it has a zero mean. Okay, thus this is the standard notation for Gaussian n, and it has a certain sigma. Okay, so what is the bit error rate in this case? So you need to know the distribution of V plus N. You know the distribution of N. So you need the, you know the distribution of N. So this is, it has a zero mean and a certain variance. Okay, what is the distribution of V plus N? it is just shifted. V is a constant as far as this calculation is concerned. So if this is V, then the distribution of V plus N is like this. It's exactly the same curve that is shifted to the right. And what is the probability of the error? So this is the density function. Okay, you make an error if you venture into this region. So the area under this curve for regions less than 0 is the probability of error. Okay, or the bit error rate. No, I haven't said what V is. If ISI is included, V becomes smaller. Okay. So before, in the ideal case, what you had was, if you transmitted a plus 1 symbol, so you would have plus 1 volt, and the noise distribution would be shifted by 1 volt, and this would be the, this area would represent the bit error rate. Now with inter-symbol interference, we know that if you transmit a plus 1 volt, what you receive can be less than plus 1 volt. Okay? So the shift in the distribution is less. So it's easy to see that this area is more than this area. Okay? It gives you a larger error rate. What is? V is not a random variable. Well, we'll think about it afterwards. Okay, it may be a random variable. That's fine. So here we are just looking at the error rate of a particular symbol. Okay? So V itself has some distribution. So what do you have to do to get the overall bit error rate? Now what you have pointed out was V is not some fixed value. Okay? Just as we saw here, this is if you have a minus 1, V is different here and here. So what do we have to do to get that? So we look at all the cases, all possible values of V and average over that also. Okay? So V has some distribution, so you average over that distribution as well. How many possible values are there for V? Infinite. Why? Huh? Can be anywhere between? No. For the RC and you know the sampling rate. Okay. And you transmit plus 1, minus 1 as your symbols. How many values are there for an output symbol representing a plus 1? Infinite. Okay, we'll see that soon. Okay. So the consequence of inter-symbol interference is that it can increase the bit error rate because the voltage that you receive for a given transmitted signal can be smaller, which means that the noise margin is smaller. The signal-to-noise ratio for that particular symbol is smaller, so you can get a larger bit error rate. Okay, and you average everything, still you can see that the bit error rate for this is going to be more than the bit error rate for this because these values are either smaller than this or equal to that. Okay. And what is this area? 1 minus Q. Q. And this is actually Q function is used to define the bit error rate. So this area is nothing but the Q function of what? Where is EB? Where is 2? It's V by sigma. Okay. And what is the typical value of V by sigma? If I want to get 10 to the minus 12, what should be V by sigma? Do you know? So there is some very simple approximation to this error function. You figure out what that is. Okay? Something that you can easily calculate off your head. I think this is either 6 or 7. I forget. I think 6 is 10 to the minus 12, 7 is 10 to the minus 15 and so on. So regardless of what the absolute value of the error is, inter-symbol interference will increase the error rate. And this is a problem. And what else? Is it possible that you will get when you send a positive symbol, when you send a plus 1 symbol, you don't get any positive value at all? Is that possible? If the RC is very large, then it's certainly possible. Okay. So in fact, instead of doing this, it could do something of this sort, and maybe here it won't even reach positive values. It goes here and then slowly it comes to positive values. So if you look here, the symbols will be even smaller than before, and in this particular case it's negative, and here it is almost zero, and only if you have a long string of ones will it reach plus 1. Okay. So this is also possible, and in this case you get severe errors if you simply slice the data. Okay. I mean, nothing special with this, the same shifting and integrating works here, except that in this case something that was here gets shifted to something like this, so the error rate is very large. Okay, it's even more than half. So how do we characterize this then? So we have a channel and we have some response. How would we go about characterizing this? Because there seem to be so many possibilities. The value that you receive for each symbol depends on every previous symbol, but of course you don't know what data is being transmitted. So what do we do? And why will the SNR help you? No. What is RC time constant over the length of the channel? Okay, so that's what. We know the value of RC. That is fine. How would we go about characterizing it? How do you characterize the filter? The filter output depends on the exact shape of the input, but we can specify a filter without ambiguity, and I can tell you what filter I want you to build within a few seconds if both of us know something about networks and systems. What do we do? How do we specify a filter? Bandwidth? No. Bandwidth can be, bandwidth is just a number that tells you something about the magnitude, right? So let's say we are talking about 3 dB bandwidth. So I can have a filter like this, I can have a filter like this, both of them have the same bandwidth. So what is it that I need to specify? Order? No. I mean, firstly it may not be transfer function or the impulse response. Okay? If I specify the transfer function or the impulse response, I unambiguously define the filter. Okay? And this is true for what is the condition under which I can use the impulse response to characterize the filter? What? It has to be linear and time invariant. If it is that, I don't really care about what kind of filter it is. It can be distributed, it can be lumped. Okay? So as long as it's linear and time invariant, I can use the impulse response to characterize the filter. So what can we do in this case? Channel's impulse response. And how will we use it? What is the principle behind using the impulse response? So I say that I send an impulse and I get something out of the filter. What is the point of this? I never have an impulse. Why would I want to characterize it like this? You can get? So you can think of any input as a sum of shifted impulses, and so because it's a linear time invariant system, superposition holds and also time invariant, so shifting also holds. So any input can be thought of as shifted summation of weighted impulses, or rather summation of shifted and weighted impulses. So similarly the output will be shifted and weighted impulse responses. So what do we do in this case? Is there something even simpler than an impulse, that step? This is the input data, and we said the impulse response is useful because every input can be represented as shifted summation of impulses. What is this? Shifted rect, or a pulse, right? So this is a summation of shifted pulses. That's the easiest thing to use in this case. Of course, an impulse response works. Then you have to use the impulse response and the shape of the pulse and the response of the channel. You have to use the impulse response and the shape of the pulse to get the answer. So I would rather use some other thing which will give me the output directly, which is the pulse response of the channel. Okay? If I have something like this, this consists of plus 1 and minus 1 values. So I can think of this as a pulse like this, another pulse like this, another pulse like this, and so on. Okay? So the input X is summation of the bits. This AI are the bits which have minus 1 or plus 1 values. And let me make it AK. One second. This is the summation of shifted pulses. Let's say K goes from 0 to infinity. And the unit pulse P of T is this. Okay? What were you asking? Yeah? No, where is the discontinuity? I mean, this I am assuming is a rectangular pulse. Maybe I have not drawn it like that, but these rise times are assumed to be 0. So if the rise time of this is 0 and the rise time of this is 0, there won't be any discontinuity. Yeah, that's correct. Even here there is no discontinuity. Because if I add these two, I will get this, right? I get this and this. Isn't it? Because this pulse itself is discontinuous. It is minus 1 between these two intervals and then 0 here. And it is minus 1 starting from this interval. So there is no discontinuity there. Each of these waveforms has 0 rise time. Is that okay? So I can use the pulse response to characterize this. And what is the pulse response that you want for an ideal channel? So I pass the pulse through this channel, and then I also have sampling, because I am not interested in the value of the waveform at all instants. I am only interested in the samples of the waveform. So I will look at the response between this input and this output. Okay. So if I look at the voltage here, I get something like this. Depending on the RC time constant of the channel, I can get the wave voltage here can be something like this, or it can be something of this sort. Okay. And I sample it, so I get 0, basically almost 1, then 0, 0, 0 and so on. Okay. And here I get 0, something less than 1, something more than 0, something more than 0 and so on. So after a while it goes to 0. Okay. So I am really interested in the samples. I don't care about this whole waveform. Right. So the ideal response that I want in terms of the samples is I should have a single 1 and all zeros. That is the response of an ideal channel. And I don't even care where the 1 is. It can come after some time. But as long as a pulse produces only a single 1 and the rest to be zeros, I have an ideal channel. Is that convincing? So that means that a pulse transmitted over some interval will not affect pulses transmitted over other intervals. Okay. This is the ideal channel. Okay. So I have some continuous time input and I have a discrete time output. Now I'll make it even, I'll think of the entire thing as a discrete time system by doing this. So let's say I assume a single discrete time impulse and it goes into some system that gives me a single pulse and that goes into the channel and gives me some continuous time waveform. I sample the continuous time waveform to get this samples. So between this point and this point I have a discrete time channel, and characterizing it this way helps me because this pulse is a characteristic of the transmitter. It doesn't have to be an ideal rectangle. We will assume ideal rectangle during the initial analysis, but once you start designing transmitters you will see that the transmitter itself may have a non-ideality, or you may design deliberately to have something other than a rectangle. That's also possible. Okay. So this is known as the transmit filter. Okay. So essentially if you have an impulse here, it gives you something that is P of t at the location of the input impulse. And this P of t goes through the channel and gives you this continuous time waveform, which is further sampled to get the discrete time response. Okay. And when I have data, I have a number of discrete time impulses at the input. That gives me a superposition of these pulses, which is basically the rectangular data that I had plotted originally. And that goes through the RC filter and gives me some complicated waveform. And that, when I sample, gives me some discrete time points. But the entire thing can be characterized by this discrete time channel, right? Is that okay or not? Because everything here is linear. So I can characterize it with a discrete time channel. So I want a discrete time channel whose impulse response is 1. Now it is important to note that we are talking about the impulse response after sampling. So what does it mean? I don't care if the waveform is like this. That is also an ideal channel. As long as at the sampling instance, after I sample it, I get a single 1 and all zeros, it is an ideal channel. I don't mean that there should be no part of the response beyond the first symbol interval. That is of course an ideal channel, but I don't really need that. I only need the samples to go to 0 at other points. Okay? I want the sample response to have a single 1 and all zeros. So how do we characterize the inter-symbol interference now from this? So this has inter-symbol interference. So we can look at the values of these impulses relative to the value of this and get a measure of the inter-symbol interference. So when you have this continuous time waveform, you think of one of the samples as the main sample, the sample that you want, and the rest as inter-symbol interference. And typically the main one that you want is the peak of the pulse response, but not always. It doesn't have to be. Okay. For now we will assume that it is somewhere the peak. So if the continuous time output because of pulse is something like this, so we think of this as the main value, and then TS away from it, you can have something, and all of these are, and I can also have something before, that is non-zero. So in a way, a current symbol can affect the previous symbols also. Does it make sense that the current symbol affects previous symbols? Yeah. So right now we won't worry about how we find that. We assume that we'll sample at the peak value. So that is the job of the clock recovery circuit, to sample at the right place. Okay. So right now we assume that somehow we are sampling at the right place, and the right place may not even be at the peak. Okay, that we'll discuss afterwards. So I said that a current symbol can affect previous symbols. Does it make sense? Is it possible for a causal system? No? Yes or no? No. It's not possible? Why not? What does causal system mean? Pulse response is zero before the pulse is applied. Yeah. But that's not what I am talking about here, right? So you can have a response which does something like this, which has a lot of delay before it reaches the peak. So of course causal system means it is zero here, but relative to the peak you can have other things which are non-zero before. So it does affect the previous symbols. Think about it, it is perfectly sane, there is nothing non-causal about it. It is causal, but this peak corresponds to a pulse that appeared here. Okay. So if you have a pulse that appeared at this instant, that would correspond to this pulse. That would have created a peak at this point. But this also can create a peak, can create a value here. Okay. So you can have a lot of delay and then you can affect the previous symbols. So first let's get some terminology. So this peak, or what we think of as the main response, is known as the cursor. Okay. So that's where you position your clock, that's why it's called the cursor. And everything that comes after that is known as post-cursor inter-symbol interference, and everything that comes before that is pre-cursor inter-symbol interference. Okay. Pre-cursor inter-symbol interference affects the previous bits, post-cursor affects the bits that come afterwards. And this is a discrete time impulse response, h of n, and usually we put the 0 here, so h of 0 is the cursor, and n less than 0 is precursor, n greater than 0 is postcursor. Yeah, why not? I mean, in fact, this looks largely like a simple RC circuit. Oh, sorry, yeah, for a first order RC, you can't have it, no. So if you have like high order RC, yeah, you can have that. Oh, the question was, I think you meant first order RC, right? For a first order RC, can we have precursor ISI? The pulse response of a first order RC, when you have a discontinuity, it starts rising, and when you have another discontinuity, it starts falling. So the peak is always at the end of the pulse. Okay, so there is nothing like more than one pulse behind this anyhow. But if you have a higher order RC, you can have pulse responses which are like this. So then the peak can be here and there can be some precursor elements. Is this okay? So to characterize inter-symbol interference, we use the discrete pulse response of the channel. Ideally, we would want a single one and all zeros, but in reality, it will be there will be some main part which we think of as a cursor, and there will be other non-zero elements. Okay. So let's say from here onwards, when we say the channel impulse response, this is the response that we talk about, the discrete time response of the channel. So let's say we have some response like this. So it is 0, and then this is, let's say, 3/4, 1/4 and 1/4, and again it's all zeros. This is the discrete impulse response of some channel. We don't care what channel it is, how it came from and so on. Now binary data is transmitted through this channel. How many possible values are there for the output? Is it infinity? Is it 1? 8? Why? Is the question clear? If I transmit some random binary data through this channel, I get some output, okay? And the output I know will not have just like plus 1 or minus 1. It will have a range of values. How many possible values are there? So essentially, what you get at the output will be linear combination of this. So the output that you get is summation over k, okay? Is this correct? It is the convolution of the input bits with the channel impulse response. Now, there are only 3 values in this that are non-zero. So AK, you have to consider 3 values of AK, and for 3 bits there are 8 possible combinations, okay? So there are 8 possible values of the output. And what are the values? What is the worst value? Huh? Why is that? So if I have the weighting of this to be plus 1, this is minus 1 and this is minus 1, these two subtract from the value here, okay? So you get 0.75 minus 0.25 minus 0.25. So you get 0.25 to be the worst value. So you can make the entire table. So let's say if the 3 bits are, and you go through the whole thing and you make the, and so on, finally up to, okay. What is the value you get for this? And it's all minus 1. You get only 6 values, 6 distinct values. Okay. Yeah, that's fine. So if it was maybe 1 by 4 plus epsilon, you will get those other things. So the main point was, if there are 3 non-zero elements in the impulse response, how many values you get? For binary data, you get 2 raised to the number of non-zero elements in the impulse response. So for an RC filter, the answer was right. You do get infinite number of values, but maybe those values are all bunched close to each other. So what is the value here? Here, and the same thing will repeat. Now these correspond to when a plus 1 was transmitted, and these correspond to when the minus 1 is transmitted. Note that in these values, this is the current symbol, and this is the previous symbol, and this is the one before that, okay? That's how you get this convolution. You work it out, it's quite simple. So, in these cases, minus 1 is transmitted, in these cases, plus 1 is transmitted. At least, when we transmit plus 1, there is no negative value. So, this channel is not so bad. But, when we transmit plus 1, the worst case we can get is 0.25. And in fact, the best case is even better than 1. So, the signal to noise ratio can be reduced by quite a bit compared to an ideal channel. In this case, by a factor of 4, which is a huge, let's say you design for 10 to the minus 15 error rate, that is a Q of 7. Now you have a Q of what? 1.75. So that's a very large bit error rate. Okay. So we have to do something to this to be able to receive the data with the same bit error rate. Okay. Is this clear or no? So think about this, we'll discuss it further on Monday, I guess. Okay. Any questions? So, one thing to notice that between the ideal channel where you are going to receive plus 1 volt when you transmit it plus 1 volt and this channel, there is a big reduction in the value of the symbol. So, and also you know that the error curve versus the variance of noise is quite nonlinear. Okay, it drops quite drastically. So, here you go from Q value of 7 to, let's say, Q value of 1.75, the bit error rate will probably go down to 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 2 or something. I forget what the exact translation is. So what can we do to fix this?